day and night to make this day possible. And we all know there were a lot of hiccups in it. Last time it was postponed, so they have done really a wonderful job. What I am going to talk for the next maybe 20 minutes or so is about contrast-induced nephropathy. So, a phenomenon. It has to occur in 48 to 72 hours, and you have to rule out that there is no other alternative cause for this. So this was usually considered acute kidney injury or contrast-induced acute kidney injury definition. And this graph shows you that in most cases, the decline in renal function is mild and transient. So what happens, it actually reverses back to normal. But probably, I'm using the word probably, a small percentage of patients, they can have a persistent rise in creatinine which stays there. But we really need to know that these are the patients, this persistent rise in creatinine is because of the contrast, or there are other comorbid conditions which are contributing to it. So let's go back and see this business of contrast. It was actually Walter Redford who discovered the contrast media. And you could see that this is almost one century old story. And in 1920, iodine was considered to be radio-opaque, and it is the basis of all contrast media. Why I'm showing you this all is because of a specific reason. And you could see that the first case where contrast was incriminated as the cause of acute kidney injury was way back. It's in 1954. So you can argue that at that time, probably the contrast material was totally different what we are using now. But still, this myth or this concept that contrast is dangerous to the kidneys or causes acute kidney injury arises way back. It's in 1954. Now you all will agree with me as well that over the years, this fear of contrast nephropathy or contrast-induced kidney injury has not only blossomed, but it took root. And a door was opened for thousands of papers on contrast-induced nephropathy, and every big journal started accepting these papers. The doctors, they got confused as well. And they start ignoring big things. And each time a contrast study was performed, contrast was being actually blamed for that change in creatinine, or if you say that acute kidney injury. Now over the years, because in 1954 this concept was generated, it blossomed and it was strengthened over the next maybe 20-30 years, till the practicing style of medicine, it changed altogether. And what happened actually, that the people, they moved from the practice of medicine where we say it's an art of medicine. There was clinical judgment, and people start realizing that there is more awareness about weaknesses in clinical judgment. So Dr. Gordon actually is the pioneer of evidence-based medicine. So this concept of evidence-based medicine started in 1990, late 1980s, and in 1990, this concept generated that whatever you say, nobody is going to accept that unless you prove it with evidence. And obviously, the concept of or the myth about contrast-induced nephropathy, by the time, there's a gap of almost 30 years. So it was there. So people start actually... So at that time, they published probably 4 or 5 papers in JAMA about evidence-based medicine. Thank you. So what actually happened that before the birth of evidence-based medicine, which was in late 1980s or 90s, the myth of contrast-induced nephropathy was already born. So it took a lot of time to understand that it is really a contrast-induced acute kidney injury or no. But this concept was there. And you could see that if you review the literature, maybe 2 decades back or 3 decades back, so every good journal was giving a lot of priority do anything about contrast. So people were publishing right and left, and every good journal was giving them their due share. So contrast nephropathy, radio contrast induced acute renal failure, and prophylactic strategies. So this all was published in all the big journals. So, but actually, the reported incidence in low risk group was around 1.7 to 2%. However, the literature was so conflicting that there were papers which showed that the risk of contrast-induced nephropathy is around 45 to 50%. However, this was in the high-risk group. And everything revolves around the risks. What are the risk factors, predisposing risk factors, contrast dose, the type of the contrast which was used, and what kind of the procedure was done, and ultimately everything was ending up in contrast-induced acute kidney injury or contrast-induced nephropathy. Lot of pathogenic mechanisms has been proposed, postulated, mostly from the animal data. And it was mentioned that there is vasoconstriction either because of increased endothelial level or decreased nitric oxide. There is oxidative stress or directed blood toxicity, and these were the pathogenic mechanisms which were postulated. And as I mentioned, many risk factors, depending upon which the patient was stratified as high risk or low risk, and these were modifiable or non-modifiable risk factors. You all are familiar with it, so there is no question of going into any detail of it. And then later on in 2004, a scoring system was devised on the basis of this risk factor, where each risk factor was given a number, and then the patients were stratified either low risk, intermediate, or high risk patients, depending upon whatever was your score. So if you are a 75-year-old diabetic and your creatinine is less, GFR is less than 20, so automatically you fall in the intermediate or high risk group. So you can imagine that most of our patients, the chronic kidney disease patients, most of them are diabetic, elderly population, and their GFR is already low. So most of them falling into this category. And then again, as I told you, all the journals, the literature, everybody was running after contrast-induced nephropathy, how to prevent, what kind of fluid to be used, bicarb, N-acetylcysteine, sodium chloride, and it was published everywhere. And if you just review the literature, you will find 40 randomized trials on bicarb, saline, N-acetylcysteine, and even on ascorbic acid, calcium channel blockers, statins. So everybody was publishing. Later on, you all know that once the PRESERVE trial came, so it was mentioned, okay, it's only probably a fluid and then maybe a normal saline, probably that is the best fluid to be given. Again, how much should be the volume of fluid given, a lot of studies on that. And even at that time, the data was quite conflicting. And I can show you a few papers. Due to shortage of time, I did not put them here, where they showed that even no IV fluid is non-inferior to IV fluids. It was a missing trial. So this was the background, and this was the background during which we have been trained and we have been taught that be aware of this entity, and each time wherever you are working, if you have a very active cardiology or cardiac surgery unit attached to you, so then you will be called every day, maybe 10 times, that there is a patient is going for coronary intervention and his creatinine is on the high side. But gradually, things start to change. And most of the data, they start coming from the radiology people. And this was a very famous paper by McDonald and his colleagues, where they looked into the CT scan where, yes, the contrast was IV, it was not intra-arterial as in coronary intervention. But they looked into it that what happens to those patients. This was a very large data, around 157,000 CT scans were done. 116 received contrast, almost 40,000 they didn't. And at the end of the day, they found that there is no difference in the incidence of acute kidney injury, even if you give contrast to these patients. And later on, this paper also showed that even if the GFR is low, if it is less than 30, there is no difference. So the risk of AKI is independent of contrast material exposure, even in patients with GFR less than 30. But this is mostly from the radiology people. And now, if you review the literature, now you will find that suddenly the things have changed. So over the years, there was the papers are published in contrast-induced nephropathy, prevention, what kind of fluids, and now things are starting to change. Now people have started questioning upon this concept or entity at all. And even in JSN, many other peer-reviewed journals, you will see that people have started questioning that this entity, does it really exist? And or we are overdoing it. So we all know, now the fear of contrast-induced nephropathy has taken over, and we know that fear is the lie. So actually, what happened, a patient came to me, she was around maybe 50 years old lady. She was in need of a coronary intervention. She was seen in two very good institutes in Islamabad, and she was said that you need a coronary intervention. But your creatinine is 4.5. You cannot go for the procedure. Go to the nephrologist first and bring down this creatinine to maybe less than 1.5, and then we will do the procedure. Unfortunately, this was not done for her. She came to us and we admitted her. We are in liaison with the cardiologist who usually does this procedure for us. My PG, Dr. Nosheen, is still sitting here. The procedure was supposed to be done next day, and suddenly she had a cardiac arrest and she died in her hands. CPR was done, it was unsuccessful. So the fear took over, and the fear took life of a middle-aged lady, and the fear was contrast-induced nephropathy, which was very unfortunate. So this was the statement given to that lady. You may be on hemodialysis post-procedure due to this business of contrast-induced nephropathy. And the cardiologist and radiologist, they usually are not willing to do these procedures unless being cleared by the nephrologist. And most of the time, patients, they might not need nephrologist, or maybe the nephrologist is scared as well because of this fear. But we forget that these are sometimes life and death issues. It's not all that simple. With this background, I ask myself that how often is dialysis required in the treatment of contrast-induced nephropathy? And you'll be surprised. It's only 1% maybe. Even in high-risk patients, the data says maybe 1%, maybe 3%. And those patients who require dialysis, is it really because of this contrast-induced acute kidney injury, or it is just the primary disease or comorbidities which lead to that? Nobody has any answer. But can anybody answer me? Or is it possible to answer this question? So what will happen to those patients who have been denied a coronary intervention just because of the fear of contrast-induced nephropathy? And what will be their outcome? And probably nobody would dare to have such a study, to do such a study, and we will never get an answer to this. So what kind of morbidity or mortality risk in patients with chronic kidney disease not given adequate and timely coronary intervention treatment? So nobody has any answer to it. And many of them dying, like my patient, in different places. So I personally feel that over the years, the medical community was afraid of this metformin business. And you know, since recently, we know that the guidelines have been changed about the use of metformin. So should we still be afraid? And this should we still be afraid, probably fixing for contrast-induced nephropathy. So with this background, what we did actually, we said, okay, let us see. The patients coming to our hospital, I belong to a small hospital. It's around maybe 300 plus headed hospital. Very soon, a new hospital is under construction next to this plot. And then probably it's an 11-story tower. So I can say that I belong to a big hospital as well. But what we did that all those patients who have been denied coronary intervention at different institutes, if they come to us for consultation, we started collecting them and doing a study, and in liaison with the cardiologist, we subject them to intervention. We did risk stratification according to the scoring system, which has been published already. And then we hydrated them with saline wherever it was feasible. And then we followed them 72 hours after the procedure and see what happens to them. And if you could see, most of these patients, they are in the high risk group or very high risk group. And you could see the creatinine clearance is even 5, 8, 10. And most of the patients, they are in chronic kidney disease 3, 4, or maybe 5. But not yet on dialysis. So 34% were in the very high risk group, 36 in high risk group, and then intermediate risk group. But we never inducted any patient who was in the low risk group. So it was all high or very high risk group. So the patients who underwent coronary angiogram, mostly they were around 84% of those. Few of them, they needed a CT scan. We just included them because they belong to the high risk group. Now you see, these are the patients who were denied a coronary procedure intervention just because their creatinine was high. 62% had triple vessel coronary artery disease, and few of them underwent CABG, and few of them, they needed a coronary intervention. 16% had double vessel coronary artery disease, and 7% had single vessel coronary artery disease. And only one patient out of these all, his angio was normal. So imagine, all these patients were denied a life-saving intervention just because of the fear of contrast-induced acute kidney injury. So what happened? Did they require dialysis? None of them. And the contrast-induced nephropathy, or whatever you call it, acute kidney injury, it happens in 5 patients, and if you calculate in percentage, maybe 11%. But interestingly, there was a transitory rise in creatinine. Many of the patients in the 88% of the population of this group, their creatinine, it decreased after the contrast exposure, probably because of a better cardiac output and perfusion to the kidneys. The creatinine actually it decreased. So what we are actually doing is that we are just following the random changes in creatinine, and that is giving us the appearance of a contrast-induced nephropathy. But if you see, there are patients whose creatinine is going to decrease. Where are these patients going? After the procedure. So we are just ignoring this, but we are concentrating and creating a lot of fear of this entity. So what we are doing is, we are converting a statistical noise into a clinical disease. Probably, we are manufacturing a clinical disease which is not there. So what I feel that once as a nephrologist we are making these decisions, we have to be very careful and we should weigh the risk and the benefit of using contrast. And this concept, renalism, this renalism where we feel that we have to save the kidneys even if the patient died of his primary disease is posing a lot of problem than this poor contrast itself. So probably, we all need to think over it again and again. Yes, it's always your fault. This might happen that at times you subject these patients to contrast and because of their primary disease, the things might worsen and you should be ready to take the blame. But I feel that now the time has come that we all should move forward. Professor Noman, he was just here. He was very rightly mentioning that acute kidney injury will ultimately lead to chronic kidney disease. The entity that chronic kidney disease on top of acute kidney injury, yes, it is there. But the problem is that I am just talking about a specific group of patients who might not then live up to this extent that you label them as chronic kidney disease. They might die before because of their primary disease. So we have to be very careful. When I was just checking how much time I will take, I deliberately cut down a few slides because I know there is always shortage of time. So I really want to know the opinion of my seniors, my juniors who are sitting here about this entity. And because now we all have to think together and to guide our juniors as well how to deal with this entity. So I think the time has come when we all should jump from the world of renalism and explore the world of realism. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Zahid.
To reduce a lot of consultation from cardiologists and radiologists and nephrologists are not going to excuse you for it. So, any questions?
Probably will guide us further. Now, you know, this acute kidney injury, why it behaves so differently from the acute kidney injury which Dr. Oman was just mentioned short while before? Because there is a transient rise in creatinine and then it comes back to normal. I agree that, I am not saying that you just start doing blindly this stuff. You talk to your cardiologist. I think communication is very important. They should use the minimum load, maybe low osmolar, isosmolar contrast. They can do interval type of procedure that once they can diagnose it with a small volume of contrast, and then later on, maybe after 1 week time, they can do that. But, you know, the pathophysiological mechanism, they say it causes ATN. Now, if it causes ATN, why this ATN is different from the ATN which Professor Noman was just mentioning? Then probably it's not a true ATN. There is some functional changes in the tubular epithelial cells for the short period of time, and then everything goes back to normal. So, your question is valid. I'm not saying that you should expose the patient to a high osmolar or maximum volume of contrast. A contrast less than 150 mil is usually acceptable. Above 150, yes.
Dr. Zahid, sir.
You'll be surprised. Even the KDIGO guidelines last, they mentioned give an acetylcysteine. And at the same year, the American Heart Association guidelines, they say there is no role of N-acetylcysteine. So the data about which was quoting contrast-induced acute kidney injury is itself very conflicting. But now the data which is coming, it is probably a change in paradigm. Now people are looking into it. That's why I put the example of metformin. For years, metformin was blamed for causing lactic acidosis and should not have been used. But now things are changing. I'm not saying that from today onwards when you go out, you start changing, your practicing style should change. But in a special scenario, like that lady or patients, you can't live without your heart.
Just one supplementary. I tend to believe everybody should go for the contrast study. I suppose there is no absolute contraindication. Just one supplementary question as you just
alluded. Topic and you have some experience also. What do you think the role of N-acetylcysteine? Because in the last 20 years I've been using it, they just use it. The only thing which works, I suppose, is the hydration. Hydration is, I think so.
So N-acetylcysteine, you know, there were a lot of trials, ACT and also so many others. Finally, it lost the credibility. The PRESERVE trial where it was compared, it showed there is no benefit of N-acetylcysteine, there is no benefit of a bicarb solution infusion as well. So N-acetylcysteine, it has lost its credibility altogether. The only thing which now everybody is agreeing is probably hydration. But there are trials where they showed that even no IV fluid is non-inferior to IV fluids. Yes, these are small studies. Most of the time, these are retrospective studies, observational studies. They are not randomized trials. But N-acetylcysteine probably at present, I don't think so it has any role.
Excuse me, I'm not. So in this situation, what you advise, how can you guide them, and what volume of contrast we should advise it, how should go with this case?
If you go by literature, by the McDonald paper, the CTs were done, and there was no change in incidence of acute kidney injury. Okay. And there was no change in the incidence of acute kidney injury. Further, the acute kidney injury which you see, or which you label, is more mostly once you use it intra-arterial rather than intravenous. But at the same time, if you feel that the diagnosis relies on the CT with the